weeks, we have been following along in the Gospel of John in the story that is known as the Bread of Life story. And there's an interesting thing in the structure in the Gospel of John where Jesus continually does two things. The first thing is he goes out into the crowds and he performs some great sign, turning water into wine or feeding 5,000 people with just 5 loaves of bread and a couple of fish. Then the second thing he does is he takes his disciples aside and he explains to them how this great sign illustrates some important lesson. In this story, Jesus has just fed thousands of people, has literally given them life by feeding them, and has shown them that Jesus has the power to sustain them and fulfill them all. There's enough for all of them, and that what Jesus offers them will never run out. And he takes his disciples across the sea, and he sits down with them, and he says, "See, this is what it is to believe in me. That just as I fed you with bread, what I offer you is a spiritual bread that will never run out, that will sustain you forever. There's more than enough for all of us. I am the bread of life." And this is great news, because you and I, we have it. God has offered us the bread of life. And I'm excited about that, and I want to go out and shout it from the rooftops. But I'll admit, there have been times in my life that I have not always found Jesus' words to be strengthening or reassuring. There have been difficult times when I didn't find them comforting. And there are far too many people out in the world who feel like they've been hurt far more than they've been helped by Christianity. When I was in my early 20s, I was trying to make sense of the world. I was a legitimate faith seeker. And I was struggling with, how can there be so much violence and hatred in the world in the name of religion, in the name of Christ? So I turned to the Bible for answers. And I opened up to this very passage that we have today in John 6:44, when he says, "No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father." And then we read in just 8 chapters later, then Jesus says, "No one can come to the Father except for me." And these passages seem to be in stark contrast with each other. So I went out and started asking people how do they live this contrast out in their lives. And I approached my local pastor of the church I was going to, and he said, "Don't ask such questions. You're doubting God, and you're showing him that you're faithless." And that was really hard for me to hear about myself. I moved to another church and watched as people used John 6:44 or John 16:4 as weapons against other people, telling them, "If you're not a Christian the way we tell you you should be a Christian, then God doesn't love you. If you're not faithful the way we say you should be faithful, then you're not saved, you're damned." And I watched as pastors refused communion to people because they didn't believe what the pastor told them they needed to believe. And I will always remember one instance that I witnessed of a woman crying at the bed of her dying husband, crying because she loved him and had been told by their pastor that he was going to hell forever because of what he believed, and she would never get to see him again. A lot of people have come to churches seeking to be loved and been told, "You're not welcome here. You aren't loved here." And unfortunately, it took me almost 30 years before I found somebody who said to me, "You know, there's another way of reading the Gospel of John here, these passages that you're struggling with. And that you can look at them in context a different way." He explained to me that the The Gospel of John was written to a very specific community, a small community of Jewish people who believed that Jesus was the Messiah. But they were in the midst of a larger community with them that said, following the law, as Moses handed it down to us, that's more important than Jesus. So here's our context. We have some leaders telling us, follow the strict letter of the law as I tell you it is, and God will love you. And then we have another community of people who say, no, Jesus taught us we're supposed to love each other and love God. And that's it. And if sometimes loving each other and loving God gets in the way of following the strict letter of the law, God wants us to love, to choose love. That's what this community believed, and that was the linchpin for all of these arguments, because if you use love as that linchpin, John 6:44 and John 14:6, they're not in conflict at all, actually. God does indeed love us and want us to be loved, so it draws us to Jesus. And Christ does indeed love us and teach us how to love each other, which leads us to God. It's both. We actually have both. And we can be that kind of community that patterns itself after that one, because they realized how important that was. And now you and I, in our small Christian community right here, we have an opportunity to decide what kind of church we choose to be. We can be the church that says, we are the keepers of the bread of life, and you don't deserve it, and you don't deserve it, and you don't deserve it. Or we can be the Christian community that says, no, God is the keeper of the bread of life. All we're in charge of is deciding how we're going to respond to that. And we can choose to respond to that in a way that it took me almost 30 years to find. Some of us have the good fortune of being able to find it in just a couple of years. Some of us were always born into a church that they felt welcomed and loved. And for those of you who have that case, you're very blessed. Some of us were born right here in St. Paul's, right? And have never known a place where they didn't feel like they had home. But whether you've always known it, or it took a few years, or it took decades, we're all here now. We all have the bread of life, and we have a responsibility to share it with other people who don't feel that way, who haven't known a Christian home, and who don't know that there's such a thing as a Christian church that will love them and not hurt them. Now the question becomes, how do we do that? How do we have some practical examples here? Because it's easy to say, everybody who agrees with me, let's go form this community. It's a lot harder to have practical tools to use to love people when we're in conflict with them. Fortunately, the back of the Bible is filled with letters. Most of these letters dealing with examples of Christian communities struggling in conflict with each other, trying to figure out how to make this work. And in our lesson from the letter to the Ephesians today, touches on that exact example. This letter was possibly written to some of the very same people that were in that community that was struggling in conflict in the Gospel of John. And what does he tell them? He says, put away all falsehood and let us speak the truth to each other. And that's a great example, because we understand how damaging it is to break trust. Just how hard it is to repair that afterwards. Be angry, but do not sin. We're being given permission to be angry here. And that's hard to accept for a lot of us. It's hard for me to accept that it's okay to be angry sometimes. That anger is not sin, but it's when we choose to react to our anger by lashing out and hurting someone else because of it. That's when we're getting into trouble. And I love, do not let the sun go down on your anger. Again, it's not that it's wrong to get angry. We get angry with each other sometimes because we all care so much. We all learn to is move, let that anger simmer and fester. We try to just pretend it's not there or hope it'll go away instead of talking about it. We can debate it rationally with each other. We're Episcopalians. It's what we do, right? We debate things rationally. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but what is useful for building up. And I love that we're allowed to have the feelings that we have. What we don't want to do is say something to someone else just for the purposes of tearing them down. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as Christ has forgiven you. And I love that one as well. Be tender-hearted, absolutely. Be kind. But the thing we need to remember is that forgiveness is such a powerful tool that we have at our disposal. Forgiveness, that tool that God used on us first, can be used to grow and heal and build up our community. And I love that he ends it by saying, when you do these things, you're not doing them to please God. You're not doing them to obey God. You're doing them because it makes you imitators of God as his beloved children. That Christ forgave others and loved others and built them up. Christ got angry and chose not to let the sun go down on his anger. Christ put away all falsehood. So when we pattern our lives after that, we're imitating God himself as he behaved when he was among us. Now, each and every one of us in this room has been drawn here. Just as John 6:44 says, we were drawn here by God Christ. And just as John 14:6 says, Christ is teaching us how to love and be loved, which leads us right back to God. And when we are participating in this life, we are indeed participating in the bread of life that has been offered to us. And when we follow these practical tools that have been given to us in community, we are indeed sharing in God, sharing the bread of life to others out in the world. So let us indeed